Good morning, everyone, and welcome to our 10th meeting of 2023. Before we begin, can I remind those members using electronic devices to please switch them to silent. Our first item of business is the decision to take item 3 and 4 in private and to review the evidence heard on petition PE1758 N Greyhound Racing in Scotland in private at future meetings. Are members agreed? Our next item of business this morning is consideration of petition PE1758, and I welcome to the meeting the Scottish Animal Welfare Commission. We've got Professor Cathy Dwyer, Chair, and joining us remotely, we have Mike Radford and Dr. Ellie Wiggum, members of the Commission. Members will recall that the Scottish Animal Welfare Commission submitted a report to the committee on the welfare of greyhounds used for racing in Scotland. Can I invite Cathy Dwyer to make an opening statement?
Thank you very much for the opportunity to make a statement, and thank you also for your patience. I know you have asked us a couple of times about our views on greyhound racing in response to the petition. It was important for us as the Commission that as we rely on evidence and weighing that evidence up, that we had the time to do that piece of work rather than sort of reflecting back to you the positions that other people may have put forward. So what we did following the agreement that we could spend a little bit more time on that is we looked at evidence that was available in the scientific literature. We looked at the evidence that the Greyhound Board of Great Britain put forward. We spoke to a number of different stakeholders, so that included some of the charities. We also visited the stadium at Thornton where we could observe races and talk to various people there. And so the report really is the accumulation of that evidence and how we felt that led us to make recommendations. So most of the welfare evidence that is available, as you will have seen, is largely related to injuries and fatalities at the track. And that is the aspect of racing that GBGB collects data on and regulates. But we were concerned that the welfare experience of a dog or its quality of life actually encompasses its whole life from birth to death, including where it is born, often requiring transport to the UK from Ireland, its training and kennelling, racing, which is really quite a small part of the animal's actual life, and its retirement. And so we considered the welfare aspects that were available to us, or the evidence that was available to us across that spectrum. And we also considered the issues of dogs racing under GBGB regulation, which obviously isn't occurring in Scotland at the moment, as well as independent tracks. I think, as you will probably see, the evidence was generally pretty poor, and there's not a lot of sort of scientifically independently verified data, particularly in Scotland. But we were able to draw on data that came particularly from Australia, looking at track design. And we spent a lot of time meeting with people and discussing with them. And I think that we looked at the animal welfare strategy that GBGB has put forward as their response to concerns and whether that was, in our opinion, sufficiently robust to mitigate some of the problems that we saw. I think it's important to say that we did use the GBGB data where it was available. It is not easily interrogated in the form that they present it. I spoke to an epidemiologist contact, and we both agreed that we were struggling to really be able to use that data very well. And so our best guess really is that a dog on the track has about a 1 in 4 chance of injury every time it races, and about a 1 in 200 risk of fatality in any one year, which we felt was a significant welfare issue and of great concern. And that leads us really to some of our conclusions about greyhound racing. We did accept that there are some positive aspects for welfare. So I think for dogs, running and chasing is part of a normal behaviour, and the evidence suggests that is rewarding for dogs, but we didn't feel that that was sufficient to offset the welfare risks that dogs were also exposed to. And they were obviously the risks of fatality and injury on the track. Also the fact that most dogs originate in Ireland, where there's no, obviously UK has no jurisdiction in terms of the number of puppies that a dog may have and how they're transported to the UK. And in particular, some of our concerns are around the end of life for dogs and some of the evidence that we took from people rehoming dogs. So on balance, we felt that the welfare risks to dogs being involved in racing was to have a poorer quality of life compared to a dog not involved in racing on average. We would accept that there are obviously some dogs that maybe have very positive welfare, but on average, a dog in racing probably has poorer welfare than a companion dog. We felt that there was insufficient evidence to really conclude about the independent tracks. They collect no data, that they're not required to present any data. And we were really sort of on the cusp of whether the Thornton track is truly a commercial racing track. However, I think what swayed us was the presence of a bookmaker there, and in fact that the dog track doesn't race if there's no bookmaker, but there is no vet. So we can race with a bookmaker, but we don't have a requirement to have a vet present, and we felt that that was really important, that vets would be able to provide an independent assessment of the welfare of the dogs to assess whether they were fit to race, and also, of course, to provide prompt treatment should there be a need. So we felt that if racing was to occur, then it was mandatory that a vet should be present to carry out those functions. But I guess our sort of overwhelming feeling is that if dog racing is to continue, then we need independent regulation. And we were not convinced that there was a desire for racing to continue, particularly in Scotland, as a population as a whole. There's a small, quite vocal group of people who are very keen and that racing does continue. But we were, I think, on balance, not convinced that there's a desire for racing to continue, and we would be concerned if there were any intentions to add new tracks or to expand greyhound racing in Scotland. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We're going to kick off with some questions, starting with Ariane Burgess.
Thanks, Convener. I'm going to base my questions on one of your recommendations, which relates to the welfare of the dogs, basically. So I'd be interested to hear if you could expand on the inherent risks of injuries and deaths associated with both licensed and unlicensed greyhound racing, as well as the specific risks associated with greyhound racing at the unlicensed track at Thornton.
So I think the biggest risk, and this is something where there is a reasonable amount of scientific literature, not based in Scotland, but mostly coming from Australia, that there is good evidence that where dogs run around a curved track, that there is increased risk, particularly as they hit the first bend, of collisions. So the dogs usually are running straight for about the first 100 metres, and then the degree of curvature of the bend has an impact on their risk of injuries. Racing greyhounds suffer specific injuries, and I might pass over to Ellie at some point as well, because she did some of this investigation. They suffer specific injuries, particularly around the foreleg, that we don't see in other dogs, in companion dogs or dogs running not in a race. And this is really that dogs are sight hounds, so they're following a moving lure, and they're trying to keep that in sight as they hit the corner. So they tend to bunch together as they come round a corner. And that increases the risk that they'll collide with each other, and also puts forces on, particularly on the foreleg, as they're pivoting around the corner as well as they come into that bend at speed. So our concerns are that there are specific risks of injuries, and the rates of injury, as far as we can tell with the poor quality data we have available to us, is considerably higher than the companion greyhound dog population, and there are specific types of injuries that are not really seen in other dogs. Ellie, did you want to add anything about the tracks and the risks to greyhounds?
Yes, thank you very much. Thanks,
sorry,
Kathy.
Ellie. Beg your pardon, just before we bring you in, it would be my preference that we don't actually mention by name any racetracks, and we keep the discussions around licensed and unlicensed. Now, I'm aware that there's a limited number of tracks in Scotland, but I think we should be the discussion should be around licensed and unlicensed rather than specific examples. Thank you. Ellie.
Thank you very much. So just to further Cathy's point, it's due to the racing greyhounds currently only ever both training and running anti-clockwise around an oval racetrack, it puts greater forces on the left forelimb and the right hind limb. which is very specific to running in that direction. And so they tend to get more injuries around sort of the hock of the right hind limb due to that always training in one direction. And just to add to a further point that you mentioned about specific risks of unlicensed tracks, and that's in licensed tracks where there's a vet present, all dogs racing must be deemed as fit to race. So they must have a veterinary check before they go onto the track and do their race. And if they're doing multiple races on in the same sort of day, in the same session, they need to be checked in between each race. On unlicensed tracks where there's not a requirement for veterinary presence, then that check is, I think, done either by someone based at the track or not done at all, who may not, well, who, if they're not a veterinary trained, won't have sort of the same level of potential knowledge and independence as a veterinarian would. Thank you.
Yep. I've got more. Yes, I've got more questions. Thanks, convener. I'd be interested to hear if you could expand on the animal welfare concerns across the full life cycle of greyhounds, from breeding to the kennel life to racing and beyond, which led to your conclusion that, on average, a dog bred for racing in Scotland currently has poorer welfare than the average of other dogs.
So the vast majority of greyhounds in the UK are bred in Ireland. So I think the statistics that we saw was somewhere around 87-88% of greyhounds are bred from Ireland. So although in the UK we have legislation that will control the number of puppies a breeding bitch can have, that obviously isn't enforceable in Ireland. So and without that sort of data, we don't know how many litters of puppies a female may be having. We don't know very much about the early life of those puppies, or the conditions under which they've been bred and reared. And it's sort of separated from our ability to look at that evidence. So I suppose it's lack of evidence more than anything else in that, but also potential lack of regulation. And we know that unfortunately, when animals are worth a lot of money, there is a temptation to exploit the production of those animals. So the vast majority of dogs are coming from Ireland. That means they're transported here. And again, that's a sort of a gap in our evidence about how those dogs are transported. But we do see some evidence occasionally that's not necessarily in the best way that we might like to see a dog transported here. There's a gap in the numbers between dogs that have been bred and registered in Ireland and the dogs that are in racing in Ireland and racing in GB. So some of those dogs may have just not become a racing dog, but there's concerns about the numbers of dogs or the numbers of puppies that disappear from the data, and knowing what has happened to those dogs and what their early life experiences has been. When they are here and racing, there is a difference between a dog that's racing on a regulated track is usually kept in kennels, and that's part of before they race. And that's part of the requirements, I think, to in particular to be able to check for illicit substances. Dogs that are racing on an independent track don't have to be kept under those circumstances, but some are. I think the dogs that are kept in homes are probably having a reasonable quality of life, we would hope, but certainly dogs in kennels, they're spending up to 95% of their lives in kennels. They may be meeting the animal's welfare needs just about, but they're certainly not providing a good quality of, good life for those animals in terms of their social interactions, in terms of the environmental complexity. So we would be concerned about the long duration of life that an animal might spend in a kennel, which I think leads to a poorer quality of life than the average dog. And when their racing careers is finished, some of those dogs will carry on living in a family home and may have a very similar quality of life to any other dog. But we do know that there are reasonable numbers of dogs that are being rehomed in some of the charities, are being relinquished by trainers, sometimes with injuries that the trainer is aware of, but often some of the evidence that we took suggested that the veterinary treatments or the injuries were not disclosed. So either the trainers weren't aware of them or those animals had not had veterinary treatment. And again, we were concerned that that was across the lifespan. If we compared that to the average companion animal dog, we felt that on balance, it was generally poorer for the average racing greyhound.
Okay, thanks very much for that. You've kind of touched on welfare extensively there. And in your report, you mentioned that GBGB welfare strategy did not give sufficient attention to behavioural issues and the mental states of dogs, even though that these form two out of the five domains of animal welfare. Could you expand on the importance of these domains and how they relate to greyhound welfare?
Yeah. So the model of welfare that the welfare strategy took is one that we would support. It's a very progressive view of how we might look at animal welfare. And that considers there to be sort of four physical domains that are integrated through a mental state domain. So we felt that the welfare strategy covered the nutrition part of that domain, physical health, particularly through veterinary care, and some aspects of the environment, particularly around education of kennel staff and thinking about improving kenneling for dogs. So although it covered those domains quite well, there was very little weight given to the behavioural aspects of welfare of the animals. And we would tend to think of these four being equally important for welfare. So we don't partition out the physical bits and say they're more important than the animal's behaviour. So some of the aspects that we would be concerned about, again, is the lack of social contact for dogs when they're kept in kennels for 95% of the time. Some consideration about how the dogs are handled. So I think as we've said and we acknowledge in our review that that chasing a lure is rewarding for dogs, so that is a positive aspect. But we are aware that there's very little evidence around the training aspects of dogs, so understanding behaviour and how, whether that's training is done with positive rewards or fear-inducing stimuli. I should say that we did not see evidence of a poor dog-owner relationship in our investigation, but some of the feedback that we've had from rehoming charities has been that sometimes these dogs are arriving are very fearful, very concerned about being around people, which sort of leads us to believe that they have not had a good experience with humans before then. And I think one of our concerns also with the approach of the strategy was that we felt it hadn't really tackled some of the very big structural issues, the running anti-clockwise around a curved track, and thinking about how dogs cope with the injuries, but also with this sort of quite oppressive living in a kennels all the time, which is not something we would really be recommending for a companion animal. So I think it was their approaches to that we were quite concerned about. They didn't seem very realistic, and they didn't, to us, seem to be really tackling the important welfare issues.
Mm. Thanks very much. Thanks, convener.
Thank you. Just before I bring in Jim Fairley, there's lots of the evidence you've given us is anecdotal. So you mentioned the potential for dogs to be bred in Ireland and no regulation of them, but you've got no evidence of that. And you don't have any evidence of how many puppies, if you like, are actually being transported into Scotland. You talked about training methods. You said you had no evidence, so you didn't do any work to find out whether there were positive or negative training methods. So two of the really important things, you didn't do any work to get any more evidence on that. Scotland currently has poorer welfare. The racing dog in Scotland currently has poorer welfare than the average dog in the population. Is that based on, you've talked about companion dogs, but did you compare a greyhound with other types of working dog? And is the welfare of greyhounds bred for racing less than the welfare standards less than on average for other working dogs rather than companion dogs?
So I'll try and remember all those questions, or points. There is actually reasonable evidence of the number of dogs coming from Ireland, so that is not that's not anecdotal, that's based on the evidence. There's evidence that actually GBGB produces themselves, so we looked at their own evidence in terms of dogs that were registered with the Irish Coursing Committee, which I think regulates greyhound
registrations. It's voluntary, so we don't know how many dogs fall through the cracks before then, but that's the data we have. We can also see the number of dogs that are registered each year to run with GBGB. So actually, that the transfer of dogs from Ireland to the UK is evidenced rather than it being anecdotal. We did speak to people about training of dogs. Only in the one track that we have visited, which is the independent track. And that's not the same sorts of training, that the more intensive training that the dogs at GBGB would be regulated would be going under, where they live permanently in a kennels. So some of the dogs that we saw were living in homes, and the training seemed to be they would run around the track. That's as far as we could tell. And as I said, I think our observation of those dogs and their interactions with humans were generally positive or neutral. We didn't see evidence of poor interactions between those dogs. Some of the other evidence, I suppose, and this is more concrete evidence, was from the rehoming charities who have evidence of dogs arriving with injuries, untreated injuries, as far as they could tell, various sorts. And these animals are, at least for one of the groups that we spoke to, these animals are coming from the trainers. So the trainers are voluntarily relinquishing them. It's not that these dogs have had a long period of other things happening to them. So they have come direct from a kenneled and training environment to the rehoming centre. And they were reporting larger numbers of injuries and lack of veterinary treatment for these animals, that these animals were thinner than they would expect. They had poor dentition. So in general, it felt like they were having a poorer quality of care than we would expect from an animal in the average population. You're right, we haven't, as part of our investigations, looked at working dogs in other situations. There's a limit to the number of things that we could look at any one time. And so we couldn't compare a racing greyhound with a working dog in another situation. So I can't comment on that aspect.
Thank you. Jim Fairley.
Oh, thank you, Convener. These may be daft questions, but it's just curiosities that have popped up in my head as you've been speaking. I'm sorry, I forgot your name, the girl that's remotely. Yeah, she talked about dogs running anti-clockwise all the time. Has there been any evidence or any suggestion that changing the direction of running would help the welfare of the dogs?
Ellie, do you want to look at that? I will respond to that.
Yes, so there has been some suggestions, both in the literature and speaking from some of the welfare charities, that potentially not necessarily changing direction, but rather running in a straight track would potentially reduce the number of injuries that is seen during greyhound racing. During my research, I couldn't find any firm numerical data on that, but it has been suggested as conclusions for a couple of scientific literature. And there are some straight tracks. I think the ones that we looked at were in Spain. So it does happen, but it's not currently used in the UK.
Okay, so that was just a curiosity. There's a couple of other points. Can you say how many dogs are brought over to Scotland from Ireland annually, and are they puppies or are they fully trained dogs?
There is no data collection specifically of dogs arriving in Scotland. So we, the figures that we have, because the track here is independent, and there's no requirement to collect data. So I think we acknowledge in the report that there is a gap because we have only one track, it's independent, and there's no requirement for them to produce evidence. Everybody we spoke to at the track who had a dog had acquired their dog from Ireland. We didn't meet anybody who had a Scottish bred dog or even a British bred dog. So which would seem to support the evidence that we'd seen elsewhere, that about more than 85% of the dogs are coming from Ireland. The only evidence we have on when and what state the dogs arrive at is from GBGB's own figures and some of the work that some of the other charities have done, which suggests that the dogs tend to arrive at about 6 months of age. So they live, they're bred and live in Ireland until 6 months, and then they don't start their training until they arrive in Scotland. So they'll be trained here rather in general, they would be trained here rather than arriving as a trained dog.
Okay. The inference, and I know it's not at all what you meant, but the inference of your statement earlier on that there is you can't legislate for what's happening in Ireland. What are the rules and what are the welfare conditions? What are the what would you have to do in Ireland to breed and produce top quality racing dogs in Ireland? And have you had any contact with the Irish authorities as to what regulations they have in place?
We haven't spoken directly to the authorities in Ireland. Mm-hmm. We, as part of our evidence gathering, we spoke with the RSPCA and the Dogs Trust, and they commissioned an independent report where they did try and understand a little bit more about the conditions and what was happening. And I think when we spoke with GBGB, they mentioned developing a association with the ICC to better able to understand how the flow of dogs and the conditions. So I think
can I just chip in?
Sorry, yes.
Given your remit, and given that you suggest that 87% of the dogs that race in Scotland come from Ireland, surely that's a massive gap in data gathering if you haven't engaged with Irish authorities to see what animal welfare policies they have there. Surely that's, given 87% of the dogs come from Ireland, surely you're then working on a very small number of dogs to base your recommendations on.
I mean, that's a fair point, I suppose. I think we were working on very limited evidence all the way through, to be honest. Everywhere we looked, the amount of data that we had, it would be more anecdotal evidence, I think, if we spoke to producers
in
Ireland.
But you didn't look to Ireland?
We didn't go to Ireland, no.
No, which would seem to be a massive gap, given that 87% of the dogs that race in Scotland come from there, and your recommendations are based on the whole life cycle of a greyhound.
I mean, that's a fair point, I suppose. I think the problem we have is that dogs are voluntarily registered with the ICC, so that's the only point that you would have. We have data from. My colleagues can chip in. I'm not confident that we would have been able to find much data, independent data, because it's coming from the ICC at the point where dogs are registered. So our ability to access places where dogs are being bred, I would think, is quite low. I have some colleagues working in Northern Ireland looking at breeding of dogs in general, and ability to access places where dogs are bred commercially is extremely difficult. But yes, I think that we could have looked more closely at what was happening in Ireland, or attempted to.
Okay. I think Mike Radcliffe signal to come in. Beg your pardon, Radford. Sorry, Mike. Would you like to come in?
Thank you very much, Chairman. Just to make two points. Firstly, to pick up the issue you raised about comparing welfare of racing greyhounds with other working dogs. I think it's important to appreciate that other working dogs, in the main, will be working on a day-to-day basis with their handler, with their owner, and will generally be living in a domestic environment. Whereas greyhounds, which race on registered tracks, kept in kennels away from a domestic environment, and the reason they're kept in kennels is not for the benefit of the dogs, it's for the benefit of punters, to ensure that nothing untoward is being done with these dogs so far as betting is concerned. Secondly, on the issue of dogs from Ireland, the remit of the Commission's report and inquiry was greyhound racing, or is greyhound racing in Scotland. And I think the point The important point here is that if the dogs were being bred predominantly in Scotland, then clearly Scottish authorities and ultimately the Scottish Parliament could oversee and regulate for those dogs. But at the moment, they are being bred out of our jurisdiction, and that means we have the Scottish authorities have absolutely no control over what is going on. Thank you.
Thank you. Once again, I think, you know, bear in mind we're here to scrutinise what may be legislation coming forward. It's anecdotal that you're suggesting that other working dogs other than greyhounds are kept in a domestic or generally a domestic situation. What evidence are you basing that on? Because any knowledge I have of working dogs, they're not necessarily within a domestic household or a domestic situation. They are kennelled or whatever. So is that anecdotal evidence as well?
I take that point, Chairman, but they're being kennelled generally at the handler or the owner's premises.
Okay, thank you, Jim. I think you had a supplement before we move on.
It was to come back to the Irish, but I take the point that yes, you don't have legislation, but if 87% of the dogs are coming from Ireland, and we're looking at the whole life of the animal's welfare. I think there needs to be an understanding of how these dogs are bred, the conditions that they're bred, and they're highly valuable animals by all accounts. So if they are, you would expect that the breeding of them and the welfare of them would be of priority to the people who are trying to make money of them. Now, that's just my assertion. Don't think that I'm saying that that's a fact by any stretch of the imagination. So I'm surprised that there hasn't been more contact with the Irish racing authorities to work out exactly what's happening in Ireland, and if there is the ability to be able to be far more collaborative with the Irish authorities. But the one other point I wanted to bring up is, do we not already have legislation, and you know, I may be wrong on this, but do we not already have legislation about the transportation and registration of pets that are coming into Scotland from a non-UK country?
I can pass this to Mike, but yes, I mean, we already have legislation, and I think we cited in the report the legislation that covers dogs in general, but there's nothing specific for greyhounds, but they are covered by a number of pieces of legislation like the Animal Welfare Act, like the Animal Transport Act. Mm-hmm.
Why then is there a specific reasoning, do you think, for having to have something specifically for greyhounds as opposed to the laws that already exist?
I think because the movement and transport of greyhounds is as a commercial animal, not a companion animal, particularly when they're being used for racing. I think that's a distinction between, so most of our legislation is thinking about these animals as a companion, a pet animal, where one would assume that the owner is quite motivated to improve or maintain the welfare of those animals. I think our specific concerns are this is more of an animal that's being kept for a commercial purpose. There's there's exchange of quite large sums of money. And I think that our concern is that opens up the opportunity for there to be exploitation of animals in a way that there is less likely when it's a companion. I'm not suggesting that there is not trade in other companion animals, which are also worth a lot of money, which we would be also concerned about. So I suppose it's whether the regulation is sufficient for the movement of dogs for racing. And they are worth a lot of money, but they're also, you know, the evidence that we collected from the rehoming charities that they're also quite disposable. That if the animal is not running fast enough, the dog has some injury, then even a very expensive dog is relinquished to a charity for and replaced with another dog.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Mercedes Villalba.
Thanks, Convener, and thanks to our witnesses for coming today. The Scottish Animal Welfare Commission report makes recommendations around minimising and monitoring welfare risks, specifically for the presence of a veterinarian when dogs are racing, for the collection of independent data on injuries and fatalities at stadia, and for a review of these metrics and consideration of whether racing should continue within the next 3 to 5 years. However, the report concludes that even if a dog track is regulated by the Greyhound Board of Great Britain, which requires a vet to be present when dogs are racing, that even then, any welfare strategy is, quote, unlikely to have a significant impact on injury rates in dogs in the foreseeable future. So in light of this, would a better course of action not be for a more immediate phase out of dog racing?
I mean, that is an option that we considered. I think one of our concerns with all the regulation of racing in the UK is it's regulated by the industry itself. So it's not independent. And I think that was one of our concerns, that there's clearly an issue where if your livelihood is about making money out of racing greyhounds and you're also regulating their welfare, that's not independent. Cool. And there's a concern there. And we considered whether we felt that that racing could be safe for greyhounds from the welfare perspective if there was independent oversight. I think we felt with the independent track here that there was some positive benefits for the dogs living in a home environment who came and raced. It's beyond our remit, but we were also persuaded by some of the people we spoke to that there was a social benefit to those people as well of attending. And that was made very forcefully to us by a number of people, that this was their one opportunity to go out of the house and speak to like-minded people. It was difficult because that's not really our remit, but I think it's worth mentioning that there is this broader context. Our problem with the independent track is that there is no data. They're not required to collect data. They recalled an injury or two or a fatality, but there's no verification of that data. So I guess we were concerned that we were making a decision for on this track on almost no data whatsoever, and we felt that if there was an opportunity to collect data, we would have a better understanding of the welfare risks to dogs. Given that some of these dogs are not living in kennels and probably are coming from Ireland, but I accept that we don't know perhaps enough about those conditions for those dogs. So we did consider whether calling for a phased ban was the right approach or not. I think it was very narrow for us whether that was... And I think one of the things that perhaps persuaded us was the view from a number of participants in the racing that they're already undergoing a phased ending of the racing because there's, you know, the number of people attending is dwindling, they're an ageing population, and it was really how far we needed to push that, something that was maybe already occurring, and perhaps a way of bringing a vet into the track would actually help us to regulate the welfare issues as that that track potentially fades out.
And to confirm, it's the view of the Scottish Animal Welfare Commission that racing at unlicensed tracks should not continue?
No, we stated that we didn't have sufficient evidence to know whether the independent track should continue or not. So
does this not contradict the body's previous statement in May that it didn't support the continuation of greyhound racing at unlicensed tracks in Scotland?
Without independent regulation, I think we have said, I think throughout, that our view is that when there's commercial exploitation of animals is possible, then we need independent oversight. So our suggestion is that having an independent vet there would provide some of that independent oversight. We, at the time when we were asked to make a statement, we were concerned about racing in general, and we felt that any activity where there was no regulation whatsoever, no oversight, independent regulation, we would be concerned about the welfare of animals in those situations. And I think having explored that in more detail, we felt that there was lack of evidence, but in general, we weren't of the opinion that the independent track was any worse
than, at least as far as we could tell, than a GBGB regulated track.
Thank you.
Beatrice Wishart.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning. You're proposing that vets should be at the track for animal welfare reasons. And you're also proposing that, or suggesting that they should gather data, because, as you've already outlined quite clearly, there's a lack of evidence. So the vets would gather data on any injuries or fatalities. Would the Commission be coordinating this data gathering and analysing the figures?
That's not really a part of our remit. I mean, we would be very happy to work with anybody doing that, to look at those figures, but it's not really within our remit to do that sort of activity.
And who would you anticipate would be paying for the vet at the racetrack?
I assumed if someone was going to run a racetrack, then they are responsible for the costs of carrying out that enterprise.
And has any assessment been carried out on what that might, how that might impact the business?
Not by us, no.
No. Thank you.
Alistair Allen.
Thank you, Convener. You've recommended that no further new greyhound tracks are permitted in Scotland. So can you just clarify, permitted by whom? Is this by an independent agency, by local authorities, or by the criminal law? Or what do you mean by not permitted?
I might want to come in here on this one, but I assumed it would be that they would require planning permission, and we would imagine that the evidence that we gathered suggests that there's not a strong business case to be made for this anyway. There seems to be a lack of interest in the Scottish public in general of attending greyhound racing. That's borne out by the demographic, if you like, of the people that we saw attending a track anyway. So I imagine it's unlikely to be a serious business proposition anyway, but one of our concerns was that there had been a call for a phased end to greyhound racing in England and Wales by Dogs Trust, RSPCA and Blue Cross. And if that was to occur and we didn't have something similar in Scotland, we might see a movement of all greyhound racing coming north of the border. And we were concerned that that would not improve the welfare of dogs in Scotland.
Yeah, as I say, I'm not suggesting it's your job to decide what the law should be particularly, but I was just curious whether you thought it should be a criminal offence to run an event like this, or whether you felt it should be... whether there should be a law basically to achieve the ends that you're talking about.
I'm going to ask the lawyer in the room in Sauk to address this one, please, Mike.
Thank you very much. I come in, Convener.
Yes, go ahead, Mike.
Thank you very much. It's common ground that there are significant welfare problems with greyhound racing. As the committee will be aware, the GBGB has recently launched a welfare strategy. Our problem with that strategy is, firstly, it relies entirely on financing from the bookmaking industry, and it's not clear that financing is going to be forthcoming. And secondly, we have reservations about whether that welfare strategy adequately addresses all the issues, and some of those have been discussed already. Now, Scotland is in a fortunate position at present, in that there are no regulated greyhound tracks. And so if it is decided that it would be undesirable for greyhound racing to be introduced into Scotland, it would clearly be open to Parliament to pass legislation preventing that, essentially banning greyhound racing in Scotland. And there is a precedent for this, so far as animal welfare is concerned, in relation to fur farming. In 2000, the Westminster Parliament banned fur farming so far as England was concerned. In 2002, the Scottish Parliament enacted similar legislation banning fur farming in Scotland. There were no fur farms in Scotland. It was to prevent the industry moving from England, where it had been banned, to Scotland. And of course, from a point of view of issues like proportionality and the Human Rights Act and such like, it is easier to ban something which doesn't exist rather than to ban it after the event and it's been established, because there's issues of compensation and so on and so forth.
Can I ask finally on that point? I think you mentioned earlier on when we're talking about the decline of this activity, you mentioned that races meetings only take place if there is a bookmaker who turns up. If there is this decline going on, are we at the point where bookmakers don't turn up, are unlikely to turn up, or less likely to turn up, or is how interested is the betting, the gambling industry in this activity?
And again, we were only relying on anecdotal evidence. There was a single bookmaker that we spoke to, who was the only one present, and he suggested he did it as a sort of a service to allow racing to continue. And we noted that that one of the reasons why a race meet had been cancelled was because the bookmaker was sick and unable to attend. So it seemed that there was a sort of a relationship between the bookie and the stadium that if they didn't attend, then racing didn't occur. But we were, it's only anecdotal evidence to know whether it is worth his while turning up or not.
Thank you.
So it does open the question up to why people spend significant amounts of money on greyhounds to race in Scotland, when actually it's all down to whether one individual is feeling kind-hearted enough to actually run a book on the race, which seems bizarre. Can you tell me, we're going back a bit, if you like, where else, where you have animals race, whatever, so in the horse racing industry, we have vets present there. Is that paid for by the bookies, or is it paid for by the sport itself? And is that something that's been ruled out by those running greyhound tracks in Scotland? Is that right?
Having a vet present. Mm. When we discussed with the track, they had a vet who had attended in the past. It was a vet who was interested in greyhound racing and brought their own dogs to race, so they were not really independent, I suppose. And I think they had ceased to come for various personal reasons, as far as we could tell. So there hadn't been a sort of independent veterinary presence. I'm not certain I can comment on horse racing. It's not something we've looked at as SAWC, unless either Mike or Ellie has more knowledge of that, of who pays for the veterinary. I imagine it's the Horse Racing Betting Levy Board. That would be my guess, but I'm not an expert, I'm afraid.
Yep. Okay. Did Mike or Ellie indicate no? Okay, I'll move on to a question from Karen Adam.
Thank you, Convener. And just really following on from what you were asking there, it says in the report that there was no evidence found that the industry was prepared to make any radical changes that would be required to achieve improved dog welfare. So I was just wondering, could you tell us what conversations you had, what kind of engagement you had to come to that conclusion?
Yep, we met with the Greyhound Racing Board of Great Britain. So we met with the CEO and a number of people involved in enforcement and regulation of greyhound racing. Mm. And we also met with the author of the welfare strategy. And so we talked in, I think, a lot of detail, really, about the sort of opportunities they had. They were pretty frank about, I think, the point that Mike has raised, that this needs to be funded by voluntary contributions from the bookies for the welfare strategy to be fully implemented. They were fairly open about the limited powers of enforcement that they actually have. So it was...
I think that we felt that it was quite voluntary based. The whole thing was quite voluntary. It required the licensed tracks to agree to take up the strategy. It required the bookies to choose to pay into a pot to allow those things to happen. Again, it was still being regulated by the industry itself, and they were comfortable with that as a way forward rather than thinking that they made it an independent regulator. We talked about the issues with the curvature of the track, and they suggested that there's quite good scientific evidence that this is an issue, but they were slightly dissembling, shall we say, and said that there were other issues that were also important. There was certainly no... I imagine it's not very feasible, but they hadn't really thought about changing track design, or even, I think, the point about could they run both directions. So those sorts of issues are not really being raised. And some of the suggested approaches... particularly around the sort of degree of injuries and the fatalities, we felt had not been very thoroughly addressed in the strategy. They had dealt with the easier bits and not perhaps the core issue of the rates of injuries and fatalities.
Okay, thank you.
I've got supplements from Rachel Hamilton and then Jenny Minto.
It's just on a supplemental and this, then I have another question, Convener. But what is the difference between the track design in Australia and the UK?
Very little, as far as we can tell. I mean, I think there's no one sort of pattern of track design. If you look, even I think we just looked at two different tracks, and you can see that they're very different shapes, but they're all run anti-clockwise. Most all the dog tracks in the UK, and I think most dog tracks now run on sand, as it's not as damaging as running on grass, for example. There is some work looking at the shape and the camber and some of the ways of sort of manipulating track design. The reference to Australia is really that's a place where their money has gone into research to look at those track features. And there is no similar work that's been carried out in the UK. So that's really the reason for looking at the Australian literature rather than because there isn't anything else, essentially.
But just going back to the Australian example, does that mean that with the work that they're doing, that they're making recommendations to make changes?
There has been some suggestions to alter, to cite barriers in places where higher rates of crashes occur. And they have suggested changes to design to alter the shape of the curve as the dog, particularly that first curve, which seems to be the place where most of the collisions occur.
Okay, and is that something that you would recommend for tracks here?
I think it would be better than the status quo. So if tracks were going to continue and it running on a straight track wasn't possible, where you can avoid these curves, then there is the opportunity to make changes to the track design. I think a lot of the papers in Australia have focused on the mechanics and the physical properties of the animals running. So the evidence, the scientific evidence in the literature suggests that if you change, but we have no evidence of sort of before and after an intervention to make that change to see whether that does actually improve the rates of injuries.
Okay. Are you going on to four? Because
I tell you, why just on the back of Rachel's question, why wasn't one of your recommendations that if there was any new tracks that they would adopt practices which had a mitigating presence on dogs?
I guess for the reason that at the moment those are all theoretical. So there's no evidence that if a track is redesigned that there is actually a substantial improvement in injury and fatality rates. It is hard to interrogate, I think to make the point again, I suppose, it is really hard to interrogate the GBGB data because it's not presented per stadium. So we know stadiums are different shapes, and it may well be that there is evidence that they have that say these stadiums are better than those, but we were unable to access it because they don't present the data in that way. So they hold that data.
Because one of your main recommendations is that there's a vet present, but that's not going to stop dogs getting injured. It's maybe going to stop dogs racing that are more susceptible to injury, yeah, but it's not actually going to stop them being injured, whereas a new track design may do that. So it does seem strange that, as an animal welfare commission, you're not actually preventing, making any attempt to prevent injury. You're just, you know, suffering after an injury may take place, where there is potentially the ability to reduce injuries through track design.
Well, again, I would come back to the point that we are uncertain that there is really substantial evidence to say this will improve welfare, or this will reduce the rate of injuries. All we have is that there are... the papers are quite theoretical, so they look at the speed at which dogs run, the forces that dogs are under when they get into the bend, and they suggest that changing track design will, in terms of a curvature. So we did suggest that if... that the tracks would need to be straight to eliminate that, that aspect, and looking at where some of these tracks are, it's hard to see how that would be achieved.
Okay.
I think our other concerns from having a vet present do speak to other aspects of dog welfare, not just the rates of injuries, but also the fitness to run and other minor injuries and biosecurity and other welfare aspects.
Okay, thank you. I think Mike signaled to come in, then I'll get bring Rachel in, I think, again, and then Jenny.
Thank you, Convener. Firstly, just for the information of the committee, going back to horse racing, there is a 10% levy on what are described as levyable bets. The definition of a levyable bet is contained in legislation. The bookmakers are making a substantial contribution to horse racing. And on the point of why we didn't make recommendations of certain conditions, if you look at the summary of our recommendations in our report, number three is we recommend that no further new greyhound tracks are permitted in Scotland. We are not convinced that any of the current proposed measures can safeguard greyhound welfare appropriately and believe that this will help to reduce suffering in Scotland. In other words, our view is that there aren't any regulated tracks in Scotland. There shouldn't become any regulated tracks in Scotland, and therefore, having concluded that there wasn't a lot of point in looking at mitigating circumstances that would have permitted or would have found, we was concluded that greyhound racing in Scotland is desirable.
Okay, thank you. Rachel Hamilton for a small brief.
Why a small one?
Because I thought you were bringing to the end your conversation.
No, I have
go
got,
for it. Go
right,
for it.
Okay. I was interested in some of the points that were raised by the convener and Jim Fairley on the transportation. Now, we have considerable legislative powers in Scotland through animal welfare protection and welfare. And I wondered what the Scottish Animal Welfare Commission's view is on the current operation of the legislation in Scotland to protect animals from transportation right through to kept animals and beyond, and why within that, considering it's such a large part of your concern, that hadn't been made as part of a recommendation to say that those bits weren't working. Mm-hmm.
I'm not sure I would agree that it's a large part of our concern is the transport of dogs. It's a component of the life of a dog, a racing greyhound, is that it will be transported if it's bred in Ireland, it'll be transported here. I'll ask Mike to come in as well, but we have done some work, some research work in my research team on animal transport, and the transportation of dogs, the legislation is not based on very substantial scientific evidence. There has not been a lot of research on the transport of dogs and the requirements for the transportation of dogs. So I think there is a gap in our understanding of the consequences of transport for dogs.
So dogs coming from Ireland are making a ferry crossing. We know that animals are become nauseous when and that they're subjected to seasickness in the same way that we are. So there are a number of concerns that we might have around the transportation of dogs, how long they can be transported for without food and water, for example. Which there is legislation on that, but it's not based on, in my opinion, very strong scientific evidence of the impact of that on the dog. I don't know whether Mike wants to come in on...
Yes, if I may. Simply to say this, that clearly the journey is significant, but it's only a small part of our reservations about these dogs coming from Ireland. The legislation only applies to the journey time and the conditions in which the journey takes place. Our concern about the number of dogs coming from Ireland is that this is completely the way they are bred, chosen to come, and what happens to the rest of them. That whole background is totally outside the remit of UK authorities.
Yeah, well, that's exactly why I'm making this point, because in Cathy's initial statement, she said that there are invisible issues with breeding. Now, I'm just a bit concerned that this document, really, on the recommendations, is not really going to improve the lives of four greyhounds, because the issues that you're discussing, including breeding in Ireland and transportation, as you referred to in response to my colleague Jim Fairley, are out of our control. So what would you suggest that those significant issues that you raise, how this committee takes that forward?
So there is a market for greyhounds in the UK coming from Ireland. So that is a pull of dogs, and they have to come here. But when they are here, if they're involved in racing, our concerns are the risks to those dogs when they're involved in racing.
But there's legislation in place to protect animal welfare. So why isn't Scottish Animal Welfare Commission looking at the current Scottish legislation rather than looking at other aspects? Because if you're concerned about greyhounds, there must be, and they're obviously a commercial dog, but you must be concerned about other animals and other dogs.
Well, we do a number of pieces of work, but this was in response to a direct request from you to give us to give information about racing greyhounds. I think the legislation that protects dogs is clearly not protecting racing greyhounds from having higher rates of fatalities and injuries when they're racing on the track compared to other dogs.
Okay.
Jenny Minto.
Thank you, Convener. I was following really on from Karen's question about improved dog welfare. In the introduction to your report, you talked about the term cruelty, which has been used and sometimes as a synonym. I can't get my words out today. My apologies for welfare. So I just wonder if you could put on the record the difference and between these two descriptive phrases.
Yes, thank you. I think it's something that's quite important to understand. So cruelty is a deliberate or negligent desire to cause suffering to an animal. The welfare of an animal is a continuum from poor to good, if you like, or to very good. So we can't talk about good. We talk about good welfare, but we can't talk about that in terms of cruelty. Mm-hmm. So welfare is the animal's mental state, essentially, and it's about how it deals with the physical environment, the psychological environment. It's about its sort of physical mental health as it engages with the environment. And so that can go from very poor to very good, and it's a property of the animal, whereas cruelty is really something that we might do to the animal to cause it to experience very poor welfare. So they are, to my mind, they're quite separate concepts. I think they are often blurred together. So if you know, we could talk about, is greyhound racing cruel? And I would probably, I would say it causes poor welfare, but it, whether it's cruel or not is a different concept, a different question, and it's not something that we addressed in the report.
Okay, thank you.
Can I ask, the current, when we took some evidence previously, the Scottish Government's response was that there was legislation specifically which named greyhound racing to protect animal welfare was in place. Why is that not sufficient to address the issues that, you know, the petitioner has brought up and the situations that you looked into?
I suppose it's, it does actually sort of lead back to the previous response, the previous question, is that welfare exists on this sort of continuum, and I guess our goal as the Commission would be to encourage practices that provide animals with good welfare. We might believe that the legislation is going to avoid the worst cruelties, perhaps. That's what it's designed to do. It provides the lowest baseline. I suppose if we take a sort of utilitarian ethical view, we might believe that, do people need greyhound racing? Is it important ethically for human happiness? And if so, we might be prepared to offset some poorer welfare from that perspective. But if we don't believe it's actually essential for human happiness, then I'm not convinced that we should be living with a low or minimum standard of welfare when we could be suggesting that animals should be kept in good welfare.
Thank you. That's a useful response. I appreciate that. Mike indicated you'd like to come in.
Thank you, Convener. Just on the distinction, so far as legislation is concerned, between cruelty and welfare. Cruelty is defined in law as causing an animal unnecessary suffering. So first of all, it would have to be demonstrated that the animal suffered, and then the question is that suffering unnecessary? Greyhound racing is at present lawful. It's a lawful activity, and therefore a court may well say, well, an animal has suffered, but this is the sort of suffering that one would normally expect from the activities. For example, injuries because of the of running around in a circle. Whereas welfare is about an animal's quality of life throughout its life. And so we're concentrating principally on welfare, on the animal's quality of life throughout its life in this report. And the question would be, if there was a proposal to introduce regulated greyhound racing in Scotland, would that be considered to the benefit, the welfare benefit of the animals concerned? And our conclusion is that argument cannot be sustained because of the inherent welfare issues.
Thank you. That is really helpful. But I'm going to go back to what the Cabinet Secretary stated in Parliament on the 3rd of March, which was that the provision of Animal Health and Welfare Scotland Act 2006, as amended, are sufficient to ensure that actions can be taken if the welfare of greyhounds, whether racing or retired, is not being met. And the provisions of Part 2 of the Act apply to all people responsible for animals, including breeders, trainers and owners of greyhound racing. These provisions include making offence to cause or permit unnecessary suffering. So, in a way, you know, Cathy, you helpfully suggested the difference between cruelty and animal welfare. The Cabinet Secretary is suggesting that the legislation in place does cover welfare.
But with respect to the Cabinet Secretary, The welfare offence is the requirement is to do all that is reasonable in the circumstances, and therefore the circumstances surrounding greyhound racing would be relevant for the court to take into account. In other words, what is the lawful in greyhound racing may not be lawful if you were keeping a dog in a domestic environment as a companion animal. So the context is significant.
In that same context, other provisions, including in those powers, are for inspectors to gather evidence and to issue care notices if an animal welfare's needs are not being met, and to take animals into possession to protect their welfare if they are suffering or likely to suffer if their circumstances don't change. Are you aware of any care notices issued to any greyhound owners or greyhound track owners in Scotland under that provision?
I believe the SSPCA gave us evidence on this, and there haven't been. They have carried out a number of inspections. I think their sort of informal feedback was that it had met the letter of the law.
Okay, so it may be a lack of clear guidance in the current law that's the issue here, rather than the need for additional legislation.
Potentially, yes. I mean, I guess from, I think just to sort of reiterate Mike's point, again, it's whether we believe that the potential for suffering for greyhounds is acceptable for the purposes for which those dogs are being kept. It feeds back, I guess, to Mike's point about what's acceptable for a dog that's kept for this purpose.
So we maybe need more clarity on existing legislation, which would address that.
Potentially.
Okay, thanks. I should have said right at the start of the meeting, we're joined with Mark Ruskell, MSP, who's got a particular interest in this. Whilst not a member of the committee, he's joined us today. Mark, would you like to
ask some questions? Thanks very much, convener. It's been a very, very interesting and enlightening session. I just had a couple of very quick questions. One was about the report, and the report mentions the situation where we have greyhounds that are being trained and live in Scotland but are also going over to England to race, where there is more of a greyhound racing industry. And I think you recommended independent regulation in that scenario. So I wonder if you could explain what you think the Scottish Parliament, Scottish Government's powers would be in relation to that aspect of regulation, because it's something we haven't touched on yet this morning.
Well, I'm not sure I'm an expert in being able to suggest what the powers should be. I think our sort of governing principle for a lot of our work really is that the animals are used in many different ways where people make money. And then if that is the case, then there's the opportunity for animals to be exploited. For some of those practices, we do have independent regulation, but for a lot of companion animal issues in particular, and we would sort of draw greyhound racing into that, there's very little structured sort of independent regulation of any of the things that we might do with those animals. So our concern was that even if racing ceased in Scotland, it's still, and there are people who are training, there's a number of trainers who live in Scotland who will train dogs that are kept in kennels because they're racing on GBGB regulated tracks, and they are subject to the regulation by GBGB. But we are concerned that, for the reasons we've sort of outlined, that is not an independent assessment of the welfare of those dogs, and that there is at least the opportunity that there may be concerns about the welfare of those dogs because there isn't an independent oversight, that the people involved in regulating that are also involved in the sort of income generation from dog racing. I don't know, Mike, whether you wanted to add anything more?
Mike? Simply to say, given that legislation specific to greyhound racing has been raised, I think it's important to understand that there is specific legislation the welfare of greyhounds under the English equivalent, their Animal Welfare Act, but no subsequent, no equivalent secondary legislation has been introduced by the Scottish Parliament. Now, in part, that is because there aren't any regulated tracks in Scotland. In England, they've gone for regulation because they've already got these pre-existing tracks, and there would be issues about proportionality and so on and so forth if they sought to ban them. In Scotland, we are in the desirable situation of not having any tracks. Therefore, apart from the one unregulated track, but as our report indicates, we question whether that unregulated tracks in Scotland have a long-term future anyway. So far as regulated tracks are concerned, there is nothing to regulate. There's nothing to pass legislation for in terms of regulation. And therefore, given that there's nothing here, and in our conclusion, the welfare of racing greyhounds is going to be compromised, surely better to prevent the industry moving here rather than introduce regulations which, by definition, would be permissive. If you regulate the industry, then it's saying it's permitting the industry to exist, subject to meeting those regulations.
You also conclude that a phase out of greyhound racing would be desirable. Can you say how you think a phase out would work, and what the difference would be between a phase out and just an outright ban? Mm.
I think one of the concerns with an outright ban is there are dogs in the system at the moment, and how is that managed? That if there was a ban tomorrow, what would happen to those dogs that are in training in kennels, are racing dogs? A number of the animal charities that we spoke to, the rehoming charities, are already close to capacity, if not beyond. So there isn't really a place for those dogs to go. If they are going to be rehomed. It seems unrealistic to expect them all to become the pets of the current owners and trainers. And actually, our evidence gathering suggested that actually leads to worse welfare often if the animals are not rehomed. So I think the point of a phased end to racing, and I think this is something that was suggested by the Dogs Trust and RSPCA and Blue Cross in their thinking and their statement last year, was that this is a way of ensuring dog welfare as best as possible as racing comes to an end. In Scotland, I think, as Mike's alluded to and we've mentioned already, I think there is, it feels like it's coming to an end naturally anyway. There's a reduction in the number of dogs present, there's a reduction in the number of people present. There's still reasonable numbers of dogs being rehomed, and I suppose it's obvious some of these dogs are not racing in Scotland because the figures just don't match up, so they are racing elsewhere, which again is one of our concerns about regulating dogs living in Scotland but actually racing elsewhere. But I think that it feels like we're coming to a natural end anyway, and how much effort wants to be put into pushing that a bit further along or allowing it to reach a natural end where perhaps dog welfare can be, for those dogs leaving racing, can be better assured than if there was an abrupt end to racing.
Thanks, Camille.
Thank you. Read between the lines. It sounds, Mike, that you would prefer an all-out ban. Is that right?
From a personal point of view, or from a commission?
Sorry, yeah, Mike, from the evidence you've given us and the comments you've made, it would appear that you want an all-out ban and not actually consider...
From a practical point of view, it seems to me that if the committee and the Parliament more generally decides that it that there are that the welfare of racing greyhounds is compromised, and that it would be undesirable for greyhound racing to expand in Scotland. Now would be the time to ban it, because if it's still permissible in Scotland and the industry moves in, it is much difficult. It raises more complicated issues to ban something that exists than to ban something that doesn't exist. And as I say, that's exactly what happened with fur farming.
Okay, thank you. There's just one other point I wanted to pick up. So one of the views was that an independent oversight and regulation is required. And one of the suggestions you had was that it might be under the auspices of the new Scottish Veterinary Service. Have you got any indication of when we might see that formulated and come into being?
No, I suppose will be the quick answer to that. I mean, I think what we were considering was who would be a suitable sort of body that might have the skills and the capacity to do this sort of job.
Okay, thank you. I don't believe there's any further questions, so it just leaves me to thank you all very much for providing evidence today. That's been hugely useful, and we appreciate the time you've taken to join us this morning. And we'll take further evidence on this petition in April and May. That concludes our meeting in public, and we now move into private session. And I suspend the meeting for a 10-minute comfort break.